Hello and welcome to Autism Specialty Care Education Series, which has been brought to you by India Autism Center and NeuroAbilities Healthcare. Through this webinar series, we hope to cover a wide range of topics and provide comprehensive evidence-based information to assist educators and families in developing effective educational programming for their children and students with ASD. I am Srirupa Chakravarti, Assistant Manager at India Autism Center, a first one of its kind integrative community project coming up in Bengal. We also have here with us Sandra Wing Lewis, Director of Marketing and Community Affairs at NeuroAbilities Healthcare, which brings together the experts needed to provide evaluation, diagnosis, and treatment for individuals across the lifespan with neurological, behavioral, developmental, and cognitive concerns. This webinar series highlights many of the specialty care services of NeuroAbilities and the experts who work together to bring patients of all ages personalized care. Ms. Kathleen currently serves as CEO of NeuroAbilities, a healthcare organization where she is charged with increasing clinical outcomes by implementing an interdisciplinary model of intervention including neurology, neuropsychology, behavior analysis, speech and language, and occupational therapy services. During her tenure at Temple University and the University of North Texas, where she received her Master of Science degree in Behavior Analysis, Ms. Tengel implemented ABA treatment programs for children with autism, as well as developed and implemented caretaker training programs to allow children to be successful within their family unit. She maintains a unique skill set in providing high-quality care through standardized and replicable intervention models. In addition, Ms. Tengel is skilled in OPM and ensures the systems are implemented from the hiring and training of staff to budget development and long-range planning to ensure the clinical outcomes are maximized. Jennifer Schwartz, BCBA, is a board-certified behavior analyst providing supervision and ABA therapy at NeuroAbilities Healthcare Autism Treatment Center in King of Prussia. After earning a degree in Applied Behavior Analysis from Binghamton University in New York, Jennifer gained additional experience at the New England Center for Children in Massachusetts, providing direct therapy, case management, and staff and family training. Jennifer has provided ABA therapy and supervision in both home and residential settings. When asked about the value of ABA for children with autism, she shares, ABA is a proven and effective method in teaching children with autism. Using ABA, I can help individuals learn the skills they need to live a more independent life. In her free time, Jennifer loves to hike, swim, and cook. Jennifer and Kathleen will be talking on how to address challenging behaviors of individuals with ASD.
Great. Thank you so much. And Bhagavad Dhanyavad for those of you on the line from India, and good morning to those of you who are in the United States. I am Kathleen Stengel, and today we're going to be presenting about behavior challenges for individuals with autism. Specifically, a lot of the behaviors that we tend to look at for children with autism are generally speaking along the lines of their symptomology, meaning there's specific behavior patterns that children with autism display. I'd like to make a note here that we are not saying that specific behaviors must be reduced. We are not saying that some of the symptomology, such as stereotypical behaviors, must be reduced, but instead we are going to be going into patterns of treatment and analysis of specific behaviors that are interfering with our individual's ability to access a fully functional life. So we say out with the old and with the new, selecting, reinforcing appropriate alternative behavior. We're speaking specifically about the old behaviors that are interfering with our individual's lives. So first, I'd like to thank the Indian Autism Center. This has been an invaluable experience for those of us over in NeuroAbilities. We are very excited to be able to share our research, our practice, and all of the work that we're doing with children with autism. It is, in fact, our goal, and it is India Autism's goal, to really increase the awareness and to increase evidence-based practices for those who have autism. So thank you very much for the opportunity to share. As we discussed, we will have everyone on mute here, but please feel free to use the chat function. Sandra will be fielding some questions, but we will be leaving about 10 minutes at the end for answering and addressing any topics. So when do we need to change behavior? Again, when we talk about behavior, we're not talking about the individual characteristics of who an individual is. We're really talking about specific behaviors that we want to change. Things like danger to self or others. Oftentimes we see patterns of behavior such as aggression or maybe self-injurious behaviors or things as simple as not following instructions that might be safe behaviors. Behaviors that hinder acquisition of new skills, as well as interfering with the inclusion in family life, school, and or community settings. So the behaviors that we're discussing today are those that would interfere with an individual's ability to maximize their potential, maximize their experience, and fully include themselves to the greatest extent possible. We have to speak about a couple of things. As a behavior analyst, we maintain some clear assumptions about behavior. First and foremost, we believe that all behavior serves a purpose. This does not mean that a behavior occurs on purpose. There's a little bit of a difference there. Instead, it really means that behaviors, all of our behaviors, occur for some type of purpose, meaning I get something out of it. The environment supports, and my internal drive also supports the behavior. Basically, what we're looking at is our behaviors tend to occur to avoid things that are a drag or aren't very good, and to access things that are cool. The other thing about behavior is we as behavior analysts feel that behavior is in fact predictable. The trick is to identify the factors that predict these behaviors that we want to see and we don't want to see, but we can in fact, if we pay attention over time, collect data, and really be an objective observer, it is possible to predict behavior patterns. It's also changeable. Meaning that there is, I hear very often that, you know, so-and-so cannot be changed. Well, the person cannot be changed, but behavior patterns can, in fact, be changed over time. So the question then remains, how then shall we change behavior? And we're going to go through a series of four top-level items of what we look at as behavior analysts for all behavior. And again, some of the things that we're talking about are really for everyone, not just children with autism. It just so happens that looking objectively and really fine-tuning down to the specific behaviors, we can in fact change a lot of the symptomology of autism, especially those behaviors that are actually interfering with our individuals' lives. So first and foremost, we need to talk about defining. What exactly is it that we mean about the behavior? What behavior do we want to change? Then we actually have to come and we really need to diagnose or assess the function of the behavior. Like I said earlier, behavior is in fact predictable and it is purposeful. It doesn't happen on purpose, but instead it happens for a purpose, for some function. We need to assess that in order so that we can really intervene. Then we need to actually select an appropriate alternative behavior. Behavior is in fact, is a big giant puzzle. And I mean, no pun intended for the autism puzzle, but instead, behavior connects together over time and across an individual's life. If I take one of those pieces of puzzle pieces out, I need to replace it with something else, or else there's going to be a hole in that picture of who I am as an individual. So when we talk about selecting an alternative behavior, we want to remove one behavior that isn't in fact functional or adaptive for us, and instead put something else in there that is appropriate. And finally, we need to teach and reinforce. So I'll be going through the definition and the assessment aspect, and then I'll be punting over to Jennifer to talk about selecting and teaching and reinforcing behaviors. So first and foremost, define. What exactly do we mean when we speak about behavior? Well, behavior analysts tend to talk sometimes what it seems like in circles, but really we do have very succinct language. When we speak about behaviors, we generally are talking about two different versions. One is the form. What does the behavior look like? The topographical description. What exactly does the behavior look like? What does it feel like? What does it sound like? Is it too loud? Is it too low? That's our form of what a behavior is. The second part of what we speak about is, The second part will be the purpose and the function. But first and foremost, when we talk about our behaviors and pinpointing, we want to be as specific as possible about what we are speaking about. So for example, when we get phone calls from parents, my child is throwing a tantrum. My child is aggressive towards me. those specific topographical descriptions don't really help a behavior analyst really hone in. We have to talk about it as specific as possible. So we call that pinpointing what behaviors we're looking at. So what that really means is defining specifically what is targeted for change. What do we mean by the form of the behavior? We need to pinpoint it. Is it observable? Is it clear? Is it concise? Is it complete? And an example I typically give is aggression can mean many things. And between India and between the United States, aggression even there means something completely different. It's very, very culturally sensitive, as well as it could mean something completely different from a woman's point of view, from a man's point of view. So when we talk about aggression, let's talk about it in specific behavior patterns. You know, what does it look like? Is it hitting? Is it slapping? Is there spitting involved? Is it cursing? Or is it simply just avoiding someone with an aggression stare? This is what we talk about when we say define the behavior. Because for what one person might see as aggression and another person might see as aggression, if we target the wrong one, we are not making a successful treatment plan for the individuals we work with. To be very clear, behaviors are not my beliefs, my attitudes, my motivations, emotions, or personality. I do not have an aggressive personality, although some may argue in this country, but at the end of the day, we may have aggressive behaviors that we define, such as yelling and screaming. We do not have attention-seeking behavior. All too often, I hear parents say, he's seeking out attention. He's got all these attention-seeking behaviors. Well, attention-seeking behavior is talking about the purpose, not what it looks like. So tapping me on the shoulder is one version of an attention-seeking behavior, as well as raising my hand in class. And in some cases, sometimes pulling on my dress, that might be an attention-seeking behavior. All three of those are completely different, and they look completely different. If we're honing in to try and change behavior, we need to be very, very specific about the about what that behavior looks like so that we can change it adequately. So I always put this in because I find this to be an entertaining but elaborative and very illustrative slide. This is how you can recognize the various moods of a bulldog. Notice the one on the top left is a happy bulldog, but the bottom right is a suicidal bulldog. And you guys can tell the difference between. And obviously, one of these guys is a very aggressive bulldog, and you can pick out the differences between. I put this up to elaborate that the behaviors that we talk about, when we talk about those happy, depressed, pensive, angry, excited, we're talking about an umbrella of a lot of series of behavior patterns, but they really don't tell us what we're looking for. So for example, if I were actually trying to target depression or a depressed behavior, I might describe that depression as defined as crying, sleeping during the day, not necessarily participating in activities, failing to wake up in the morning, non-performance of a requested task. All of those behaviors lead up to what we would label as depression. So I put this up as illustrative that we really need to back up and talk about behaviors as specific as we possibly can. And the reason for that is that we need to then assess. If I use a medical model example, we can't very well intervene on an illness without doing a full-blown evaluation from top to bottom. We need to know exactly where in the body we're looking at when we do an evaluation from a medical perspective. It is not dissimilar when we talk about behavior. We need to assess what the purpose. Again, we go back to our assumptions. We know that behavior serves a purpose, or what we talk about as function. We need to define what that is, because without understanding what that function of the behavior is, it is very, very difficult to intervene and replace that. So how do we do that? We have to figure out why. Why is this behavior occurring? Given that we know that all behavior serves a purpose, it is necessary to understand in what context, under what circumstances, does a particular behavior increase or is displayed? When does it happen? In what context? And then what sets the occasion for said behavior to occur? From there, we tend to look about the back end of the behavior as well. What happens after? Every time I raise my hand and stay quiet and the teacher calls on me, the teacher calling on me serves as that motivational operative to continue moving forward. Our functional behavior assessment, and you'll hear this time and time again in our field, we assess what the function of the behavior is by looking at both the contextual arrangements as well as the consequences that may maintain that particular behavior. Functional behavior assessments can be done in a variety of ways, but at the end of the day, what we have to really look for is, why are these behaviors happening? Please understand that why these behaviors are happening is not what I think, but instead it's what I observe. It's what I take data on. How many times did the behavior happen? How many times was it followed by a specific event? Does it continue to happen over time? If I change those events, will that make the behavior go up or behavior go down? So there are several assessments that we typically do in our field with autism. And a lot of teachers are very well trained in this. And if they're not, I encourage to look forward to look towards doing functional assessments in the school settings. There are a lot of assessments out there, both free as well as evaluative checklists to really hone in on the why. There's three different types that we typically use. One is considered an indirect assessment. And the indirect assessment is, I'm speaking with caregivers, teachers, I'm interviewing, I'm looking to find patterns about how people are describing the events that occur. Then the direct. Almost any behavior analyst and any mother and teacher will tell you, sometimes you have to get eyes on the behavior to really fully understand in what context things are occurring, how severe is the behavior, what exactly is occurring afterwards. And that's considered our direct observation. We observe the behavior, we observe the environment, and all along the way, we're taking a lot of data to assure that our assumptions are valid. The final assessment, and this is by far the most cutting edge and the most evidence-based, is considered an experimental analysis. Experimental assessments, or analog functional analyses, or what we call them, is when we actually manipulate the events that occur both prior and after a behavior in order to ascertain whether the behavior increases or decreases as a result. We're really conducting an experiment. All too often in the practical applied field, it's very difficult to push forward an experimental analysis of behavior, especially without any specific training. So I do not encourage that unless you're a board certified behavior analyst with specific experience in experimental analysis of behavior. Having said that, when we do an experimental analysis of behavior, and typically in my practice, we do it at the very end when the indirect assessment and the direct assessment are not giving us nearly enough information or we're not finding validity within our analysis, we then move to experimental analysis. And what that is very controlled setting with a lot of individuals. The reason we tend to not do that till the very last is because in some cases we're actually intentionally increasing a behavior. And there is not one parent I've ever met that says, oh yes, please increase the aggression of my child. So it's a very, you know, dangerous assessment to do if you're not highly qualified and do not have the structures in place. Having said that, typically we will do that at the end in order to really hone in and pinpoint exactly what the functional, what the function of the behaviors are. So this is a little bit of in jest. It's all fun and games until somebody figures out the function of your behavior. So very often, you know, we as behavior analysts are always asked, you know, are you analyzing us? Are you analyzing us? And, you know, when we're out at social events, I'm like, nope, I'm off the clock. But really, we are always analyzing behaviors. And generally speaking, we can usually pinpoint the basic functions of why people are doing things, not just kids with autism, pretty much our entire populace. So this is an easy way by Dr. Teresi in 2010 of kind of giving a visual of what we mean by functions of behavior. So you notice at the top, a problem behavior occurs for really two particular purposes: in order to get something or access something, and then in order to escape. So we tend to think about this as a positive reinforcer or a negative reinforcer, meaning negative takes something away, positive adds something. So I always think about it as the addition or the subtraction. So generally speaking, it's one of these things in order to obtain or get sensory stimulation, social interaction or socially mediated events, or some type of tangible activity. Then on the other side, the negative reinforcement, the escape or avoid, behaviors may happen in order to get away from somebody, in order to get away from some type of aversive sensory or stimulation, or to get away from an activity or to get away from some type of tangible. Notice underneath the social, we break it out into two. There is a definite difference between a social interaction with an adult and a social interaction with a peer. And one thing I will say here is that sometimes we're attempting to obtain social interaction. We think about that in the vernacular, generally speaking. We think about it as, oh, good job, or a high five. That is not always the case. Social interaction could also be correcting behavior. So sometimes when moms tell me, I say no constantly, all I'm saying is no, no, no. And I keep telling him what to do and he's not doing it. And it continues to happen over and over and over again. Well, we look at that and we say, well, there's some social interaction from mom. Even saying no, even trying to correct the behavior can serve the purpose of increasing that behavior in the social domain. You know, some of the children don't even necessarily listen to the words that are coming out of our mouth, but there's a dramatic event that occurs with that exchange when mom's upset and we're going back and forth, and no, we don't want to do this, and you should do this better, and that in and of itself is social interaction that sometimes can actually increase and maintain. So the functions of behavior, we classify them into four distinct categories. Attention, like I just said, socially mediated events. Escape, let me get out of here. Let me get away from that. I'm pushing my work off of the desk because I just do not want to interact with it. Access to tangibles. My best story about that is, as a newly trained behavior analyst and a new mom, when my phone would ring, my child would drop down to the ground and start tantruming. So I would give him a lollipop because I'm on the phone. So here, have the lollipop. I knew it was wrong, but it kept him quiet enough and something in his mouth in order so I could take the phone call. But that right there is a good example of tangible. Or in some cases, and what we see more often now is children throw tantrums or display specific behaviors in order to access technology, iPads, food, water. Note, oftentimes these change depending on which context. So in some contexts, it might be that I'm displaying behaviors in order to get mom's attention. And in other contexts, I might be displaying specific behaviors, those same behaviors, in order to get access to something else. So we have to remember that in different contexts, these behaviors are multiply maintained, meaning they have different functions across. That's where that setting events and antecedents become very, very important so that we can then predict what the functional response will be. If we do in fact have some behaviors that are maintained by multiple functions, we do recommend that you seek out consultation with a trained BCBA. So again, back to attention, any event that occurs after a behavior that is socially mediated is what we classify as attention. So when a child engages in a behavior, the others attend to it in some way, shape, or form, and it increases or maintains that behavior. This cartoon is a very good example. You know, Calvin, this is a Calvin and Hobbes cartoon. You know, he skinned his knee and he's looking around and no one's around. So he looks and he goes and he's fine. He's actually not too hurt here. When we say escape, we're talking about the function, not the behavior. When kids run out of the room, we tend to call that elopement, not necessarily escape, but running out of the room may be functionally maintained by escape, meaning I'm trying to get out of something. So the behavior, generally speaking here, when it's escape, is maintained by the removal or the subtraction of something. So this is a good meme here. If you've given a task and you don't want to do it, just start crying. They'll go straight to the chair. It's like a vacation from work. So we had a call a couple of weeks ago, just a brief story about a child who was tantruming repeatedly. And the mom said, well, I punished that behavior. I continue to put him in the timeout chair. I continue to have him sit and sit and sit. Well, if he was started crying because you gave him a task and then removed the task and put him in a timeout chair, that right there is a good example of an escape maintained behavior, because the behavior continues to happen. We're getting the consequence of going in the timeout chair. That is not serving for punishment for this individual. Instead, it's actually saying, whew, nice little break from work. So that right there is a good example of an escape maintained behavior. Another function, access to tangibles. The behavior has been reinforced by gaining access to preferred items or activities. As a parent, and quite honestly, as a teacher, sometimes this is all you have in your repertoire to just like, please just be quiet, or please just, you know, access this, because we're under such stress and our behavior actually serves a purpose as well. So access to tangibles, this is not something that's wrong. This is not something that you need to look at and say, oh, we're giving into a behavior. Instead, instead look at it and say, well, the access to tangibles, they should be able to access that, but I don't want them to access the iPad, the chips, or the ball based on the maladaptive or the problematic behavior. So Jennifer will go into different alternatives in a little bit, but when we say access to tangibles is the function, that means historically, when the behavior happens, I had access to some type of activity, item, edible, event. So automatic, this is by far the hardest behavior for us as behavior analysts and parents and individuals working with people with autism. Automatic function means that the behavior is maintained by something I can't identify in the environment. It might be happening inside the skin. So what we say is that it's reinforcement that is not socially mediated. It is not access to something that I can see in the environment. There might be something going on inside. So for example, this picture here is when you move your pen. A lot of people, we all do some type of shaking, foot tapping, pen tapping. Those are all things that occur. And we can't tell you why that occurs. I can't tell you why I continue to shake my pen. It feels good. It's something that I do. It's something that helps me to occupy. It is therefore maintained by automatic reinforcement. Some examples of automatic reinforcement historically with children with autism, generally speaking, are some of our stereotypical behaviors of rocking back and forth, sometimes the flapping, sometimes the audible stereotypical responses are maintained by what we call automatic reinforcement. That means that we can't necessarily see it. Those behaviors may be, they are generally speaking, very, very difficult to change. And it's difficult to make them go down completely because I can't control what happens internally. And we'll get into some of those in a little bit. So actually, I'll scoot it over to Jen. Jen, I'll give you remote control.
Great. Thank you, Kathleen. And thank you to the IAC for having us. And thank you all for listening. So Kathleen went over how we define the behavior, how we assess the behavior. And now our next step is to select an appropriate alternative behavior. So we'll get into that a little bit. So a functionally equivalent alternative behavior is what we are looking for. We are looking for an acceptable behavior, kind of two options. They can engage in problem behavior, or they can engage in an alternative behavior to get the same function. So it's our job to select a replacement that will serve that same function. So we are looking to select an alternative behavior to replace that challenging behavior. And some suggestions from Tiger, Hanley, and Bruzek are to have a behavior that has the same function of the behavior. So that's to say that they get the same thing either way if they engage in problem behavior or if they engage in the appropriate behavior. So they're getting the same thing or they're getting out of the same thing. And we also want to consider if the problem behavior is easier to emit than the alternative behavior, they're going to keep engaging in the problem behavior. So for example, if it's easier for them to hit you or scream than to say a full sentence on a speech device saying, "I need help, please," or "I want the TV, please," they're going to engage in the behavior that's easier for them and that they have more reinforcement doing. We also want to consider how fast they'll learn the new response and if it's able to be reinforced. And I'll get into that article on the next slide. So what can you and others reinforce? We want a behavior that will work in all settings and with all instructors. So when you're teaching a new behavior, you want to make sure that you can give them access to it. So asking them to ask you to go to the beach isn't a good alternative response because you can't bring them to the beach every time they ask. We also want to make sure we can hear the response, that we can see the response if they're signing or that they have access to picture exchange cards or an AAC device. So we want to make sure that it's able to be reinforced by everyone they come across in their day. A good example was an article by Durand in 1999. They taught an individual whose behavior was maintained by escape from difficult tasks to say, "I need help," in English. So they trained it in the school setting made sure that he could say, I need help, when he encountered situations where he'd need help. And the cool thing about this article was they practiced this in the community. So when he was at a store and he couldn't get the change out of his wallet, he actually said, I need help, using the response that he had learned. And the cashier at the store, who had no training on how to respond to an individual with autism or developmental disabilities, was able to help him get the change out of the wallet. So instead of engaging in challenging behavior when he was frustrated with his wallet, he said, I need help, and he was able to get the help that he needed. So we also might want to consider teaching multiple alternative responses. It might be easier to just start with one and get that really, really solid before we teach others. But in the case where you don't hear the first response or you don't see the first response, we kind of want them to have more alternative appropriate responses in their repertoire so they can use another response before reverting back to some challenging behavior. And if you want more information on that, I would suggest you read an article by Lambert and colleagues from 2015. So we have some examples here. This is an attention example. So every time the parent goes into the kitchen to prepare a meal, the child throws themselves to the ground, cries, screams, and it's just impossible to cook. It's impossible to do anything. So you go back and try to calm the kid down so then you can get on with making your meal. So first the parent leaves the area, the kid begins to tantrum, and then the parent comes back in and calms the child down. So this is an example of the behavior we don't really want to see anymore. We don't want to see the tantrum behavior occur. Instead, we want the child to request some time with mom. So in order for them to request time with mom instead of tantruming, we need to break the connection between the parent leaving, tantruming, and the mom coming back in the room. So we teach them to request time, and we don't honor it when they begin to tantrum. An example for escape maintained behavior. So a student is working on an assignment and they swipe the paper off the desk when they're really frustrated. So in the meantime, the teacher is trying to calm down the child, trying to get the papers, get all the materials back together. And in that time, they're accessing a break when really they just want to finish the assignment. So we have the assignment is presented, they swipe the papers off the desk, and then after the teacher helps collect the assignment, the teacher helps the student finish the assignment, and then they're done with the assignment. So instead of swiping papers off the desk, we could teach the student to request help. So they can raise their hand or say, I need help. And then the teacher can come over and help the student finish the assignment faster, which is what the student wanted in the first place. So again, to break the cycle of assignment presenting, challenging behavior, teacher comes over and helps the student, we want them to engage in an appropriate response, so asking for help. So instead, we have assignment presented, they ask for help, and then the teacher helps them finish the assignment, which is exactly what they wanted. They wanted to escape it and be done with that assignment faster. For tangibles, we have each time the parent turns off the TV, the child screams, hits his or her parent, and begins to cry. So TV is turned off, they engage in aggression and crying, and to calm the child back down, they turn the TV back on. Very understandable. I would probably do the same thing if I didn't know why this behavior was occurring. So we have the top path, our challenging behavior of aggression and crying when the TV is turned off. And so what do they want? They want more time watching TV. So how can we teach them to request this in an appropriate way instead of aggression and crying? We can teach them to request more time watching TV. So then by teaching them to request more time instead of aggressing and crying, we're teaching them that this alternative response will result in watching more TV, which is what they wanted. So we want the appropriate response to be more beneficial and better for them. So we need to teach them that the bottom path, requesting more time, will work, but aggression and crying won't let you watch more TV. So for automatic reinforcement, we have a child flips the light switch on and off repeatedly while others are in the room. So the others can't see and the flashing lights might be a little disturbing. So we have the child is told to keep the light on and then they scream. And then they're allowed to flip the light back on and on and off and on and off. We can teach them an alternative behavior that doesn't allow them to turn the light on and off in the room. We can teach them to request a toy with blinking lights. So that way everyone else in the room doesn't have to deal with the lights being turned off and on them. And they are still able to access the visual stimulation with the toy. So again, we're trying to break this connection between challenging behavior of screaming when something's removed and teach them to request something to access the same thing. So how do we change behavior? We've defined, assessed, and selected the appropriate behavior. Now it's time to teach and reinforce the appropriate behavior. So, like with any new skill, we need to provide frequent practice opportunities. This is going to be difficult for a student, just like with you or I learning a new skill, like playing the piano, learning a new sport, really anything, it needs a lot of practice, and we need a lot of reinforcement at first. We need to help them emit the new response. So this is called prompting in our field. We really need to make sure they know how and what is expected and give them lots of praise and reinforcement for that behavior. And we have here that the problem behavior is on extinction. What this means is it doesn't work anymore. So crying, screaming, aggression doesn't work. In order to access the things they want, they need to engage in an appropriate behavior. So I have some few examples here of teaching the new behavior. So if your child has challenging behavior when access to food is limited, we want to teach them to ask for more appropriately. So something you can do is give them only a few items of the food they are requesting. So when they finish those four goldfish, they can ask for more, please. So by giving them only a few at a time, it gives lots and lots of opportunities for them to practice the appropriate response of more, please. Another trick for behavior that's maintained by escape from difficult situations or even access to tangible items like the Play-Doh here. If your student can't open the container on their own, you can put it in a container and they need to say, help me, before they access the toy or before you help them with the container. And with this situation, you can do this for each color Play-Doh. So if you take the purple out, you can shut the container again. And then if they want blue Play-Doh next, they need to ask you again for help. So that's, again, putting lots of opportunities to practice and reinforce them asking for help. So we call this differential reinforcement. There's a difference between using the appropriate request and not. So the appropriate request gets the thing they wanted or avoids the things they wanted to. And the inappropriate responses, there's no change. They still have to do the thing that they are asked to do, or they still don't get the item they requested for. So if you just, this is very, very hard to do, but as a parent or a teacher, just being consistent as this behavior, the appropriate one, gets the thing you want, and the inappropriate response does not. Just keeping that consistent is the way that we have behavior change. So we're gonna play a little game. It's virtual, so I can't hear you guys, but we'll still go for it anyways. So I'm going to ask if you would reinforce or not reinforce in these following situations. We have student asks for help when encounters a difficult math problem. Would you reinforce this response or would you not reinforce this? If you said reinforce this response, you would be right. We want to reinforce each time they engage in the appropriate response, so asking for help. So a student asks you for help, but before you can respond, he rips up the paper, screams, and flips the desk. Would you reinforce this behavior? No, you wouldn't. Although he asked for help, he engaged in a lot of challenging behavior before you were able to reinforce the asking for help. So we want to make sure that we don't reinforce this situation, because in this situation, what happened right before, if you do reinforce it, is flipping the desk, ripping the paper. We want to make sure the connection is there. Ask for help without any challenging behavior, reinforcement. Any challenging behavior, no reinforcement. So a student asked for help, but you didn't hear him. He said it very quietly. Would you reinforce this? Oh, I'm sorry. You did hear him, but you said it very quietly. Yes, you would reinforce this. Just because it's a little bit quieter, quieter than we would like, we can work on that later. We want to make sure that any appropriate response is reinforced when they ask for help. So in summary, behavior change is hard. This is very, very difficult. It takes many, many repetitions of the child engaging in challenging behavior, not getting the thing they wanted, and then so many more opportunities of engaging in the appropriate response and getting the reinforcement. So we as providers, parents, practitioners need to be consistent. We need to make sure every time they engage in the appropriate response, they're receiving reinforcement, praise, the thing they want to do, the thing they want to get out of. We need to make sure that's very consistent. And if they engage in challenging behavior, that we don't reinforce it. So if we keep changing what we're doing, so sometimes it's okay if you hit me, that means that they'll continue to do that, or they'll find another alternative or another inappropriate behavior that gets the same thing. So we really want to make sure that there's a difference between the appropriate behavior and getting the thing that's desired, and the inappropriate thing does not. So we want to teach functionally equivalent behaviors that continue to occur in the natural environment. And this is the only way that we will sustain the behavior change over time. So our final summary, how do we change behavior? We go from defining the behavior that needs to be changed to assessing the function or why that behavior is occurring, in what situations it's likely to occur, and then selecting an appropriate alternative behavior so we can teach and reinforce that appropriate behavior so that appropriate behavior increases and the inappropriate behavior decreases and eventually goes away.
Hi, thank you.